What's up?
To explain the pathogenesis of sickle cell anemia, we have to recall physiology.
Go into incredibly descriptive details of the story so we all know.
Oh, yes.
On chromosome 11, located gene that encodes beta-globin chains in hemoglobin structure. Recall that we have a central dogma in molecular biology, DNA, RNA, protein. This dogma tells that the genetic information in chromosomal DNA molecule has to be copied to RNA molecule and carried to ribosomes, where proteins produced. And only proteins can physically provide the function and regulation of the crucial metabolical processes. Basically, gene is a number of nucleotides that form DNA molecule. DNA molecule consists of two strands, its coding strand and non-coding strand. And to use this information in the gene, information must be carried to ribosomes, where proteins are made. So DNA molecule, for this purpose, makes a copy of the gene in form of pro-matrix RNA molecule, this process called transcription. And this results in production of pro-matrix RNA molecule. Let's suppose that our sequence of nucleotides located in a coding region that called exon. So this sequence of nucleotides will not be removed by RNA splicing, and in form of matrix RNA molecule will be delivered to ribosomes. Ribosomes read nucleotide sequence in matrix RNA molecule in codons and include complementary to that codon amino acid. In this case, it's glutamine and glutamine. And a particular amount of amino acids form protein. In our case, this protein is beta-globin chain in hemoglobin structure. Normal hemoglobin consists of two beta chains and two alpha chains. Together, they form hemoglobin A, which is normal hemoglobin in adults. Then we put hemoglobin into red blood cells, and then red blood cells enter into the peripheral circulation, where they deliver oxygen to the tissues. But sometimes, something can go wrong. The most common type of mutations called single nucleotide polymorphism. Basically, this mutation substitutes one nucleotide in DNA structure with another nucleotide. And this simple substitution, in our case, will have dramatic consequences.
The fuck is going on here?
So, in beta-globulin gene in DNA molecule, due to a single nucleotide polymorphism, adenine becomes substituted by thymine. Thereby, in non-coding strand will be adenine, in matrix RNA molecule will be uracil, and now the triplet guanine-uracil-guanine encodes not glutamine but valine, which is totally different amino acid. This results in production of pathological beta chain, and hemoglobin with such pathological beta chains we call hemoglobin S. The problem with hemoglobin S is that without oxygen, such hemoglobin is very prone to polymerization. Basically, hemoglobin S molecules in deoxygenated state stuck to each other, and they precipitate. Such precipitation results in formation of a multiple needle-shaped fibers inside the erythrocyte, and deposition of needle-shaped fibers cause formation of crescent-shaped red blood cells. Such red blood cells we call sickle cells.
I think we were supposed to be doing this, and instead, we did this.
Because hemoglobin S precipitates in deoxygenated state, any condition that increases the amount of deoxygenated hemoglobin can provoke increase in precipitation rate, and thereby increase in formation of sickle cells. First of all, it's hypoxemia, in high altitude for example. Also, it can be acidosis, because low pH forces hemoglobin S to release oxygen. So both these conditions cause increase in deoxygenated hemoglobin S that precipitates with formation of sickle cells. Sickle cells are pathological to our organism. Human organism knows how to operate with normal red blood cells, but sickle cells have unique shape and this creates two huge problems.
What?
First of all, because sickle cells are pathological, macrophages in the spleen see them as antigens. And because macrophages in the spleen are responsible for filtration of blood from pathological substances, Once they see sickle cells, they phagocyte them and destroy them. As a result, hemoglobin S is released into the blood, and the amount of red blood cells and hemoglobin decrease, so normocytic anemia develops. This process we called extravascular hemolysis. Once with extravascular hemolysis, hemoglobin S released into the blood, initially hemoglobin degrades to unconjugated bilirubin, and then to conjugated bilirubin, so the level of both bilirubins increase. Increase in unconjugated bilirubin causes jaundice. Initially, it's yellowing of the sclera, and then it's yellowing of the skin. Increase in conjugated bilirubin causes increase in concentration of bilirubin in the bile. As a result, it greatly increases the risk of bilirubin gallstones, a condition known as cholelithiasis. Also, increase in excretion of conjugated bilirubin with the urine causes a very dark color of the urine. Hemolysis of red blood cells causes decrease in red blood cell count. To compensate this, bone marrow begins to produce more red blood cells. As we know, initially bone marrow produces reticulocytes, and only after reticulocytes mature into red blood cells. So initially, the amount of reticulocytes increase, a condition known as reticulocytosis. With time, the demand for red blood cells production becomes so high that bone marrow expands even to the bones that compose our skull, and on X-ray, such bone marrow expansion we can observe as a crooked sign. If the function of the bone marrow is suppressed by some viral infection, in this state, bone marrow cannot produce enough amount of red blood cells. And when destruction of red blood cells prevails over red blood cells production, a severe anemia develops. We call such condition a aplastic crisis. The second major problem with sickle cells is that they are too rigid for our blood vessels. So because of this, sickle cells in the circulation can easily cause an occlusion of the blood vessels. Obstruction to venous outflow causes accumulation of deoxygenated blood in the organs. Obstruction of the splenic vein causes splenomegaly. Also, because we cannot use obstructed blood in our circulation, the total blood volume decreases, and because of this, blood pressure decreases. One of the specific symptoms related to venous obstruction is priapism, which is obstruction of venous outflow from the penis, and this manifests as persistent painful erection. Obstruction of the pulmonary veins causes pulmonary hypertension. Pulmonary hypertension leads to a pulmonary edema that causes so-called acute chest syndrome. Acute chest syndrome causes severe respiratory distress that has two major features. It's hypoxemia and chest pain. Also, acute chest syndrome in patients with sickle cell disease, it's a very common cause of death. Also, obstruction of the arterial circulation develops. With decrease in inflow of arterial blood to the tissues, ischemia develops. If arterial obstruction develops in extremities, it causes swelling and pain in the hands and feet, a condition known as dactylitis. Obstruction of the splenic artery causes splenic infarction. If blood do not reach spleen, spleen cannot provide its functions, so basically person becomes asplenic. Without spleen, we cannot remove the old red blood cells from the circulation, so the amount of old red blood cells will increase. Such old red blood cells we call whole jelly bodies. Also, spleen is the home of B lymphocytes, and the function of B lymphocytes is antibodies production, primarily against encapsulated bacteria. So in a splenic condition, we cannot produce antibodies into the circulation. Without antibodies, we cannot kill encapsulated bacteria, and this greatly increases the risk of infections caused by encapsulated bacteria, as streptococcus pneumonia or Neisseria meningitis. Also, occlusion of the cerebral arteries can develop, and potentially it can cause stroke, and occlusion of the renal arteries can cause acute renal failure.
Okay. Fine. Yep.
Ciao!
What's that mean?
Ciao.
It's Italian. It means food.